Human trafficking is modern-day slavery. It's sex for sale. It's people profiting off of selling humans.
We're really, all we're talking about when we're talking about human trafficking is we're talking about sex for sale. We're talking about people having a demand for a certain product, but people are involved.
Reading itself is unique. We are sitting on the I-5 corridor. We have about 60 square miles in our city, and to think it doesn't happen here, I think we're fooling ourselves.
This is happening in every community in the United States. Human trafficking accounts for $35 billion worldwide in revenue.
I've seen it directly. It's not like I've heard this from somebody else or it's this subjective thing. It's real. It's here. It's been here.
I know what I know because of what I've seen. I have been very surprised by family friends who look at us and say, you must be confused. You must not understand what was going on. I was very involved. Jason was very involved. And they would look at us and say, that didn't happen here.
It was just last month when police say a 16-year-old girl escaped from a life of prostitution. She was kidnapped out of Sacramento, threatened, and held against her will at a home here on Hartnell Avenue.
Police say the pair kidnapped a 16-year-old girl in Sacramento, brought her to Redding, and forced her into prostitution. This is the first time we've seen the couple. According to police, these two spotted the 16-year-old girl as she walked home from a party in Sacramento and forced her to get into Green's car and took her against her will. Police also say Green molested the girl several times.
On December 31st of 2013, I was taking my small children to the grocery store to pick up some dinner for New Year's Eve and stuck my kids in the car, was actively buckling one of them, and I heard screaming, and I pulled my head back out of my car, and there was a young woman running across the street screaming to call 911.
Her alleged kidnappers have since been arrested. But as you're about to see, there are many more young girls that need to be rescued.
One of the agents that I work with and one of the traffickers up in the North State that he arrested, he asked him, why are you doing it up here? And he said, well, if I go to LA, I'll get caught, but nobody catches me when I'm up here.
She explained that she was being held against her will and had been for 7 days and had been locked in a room and forced to prostitute.
Ultimately, when the case went to trial, had 7 identified young women. Some of them had been teens when they were trafficked by Melvin Baldwin Greene and Tanisha Williams. Mr. Baldwin Greene and Ms. Williams used coercion techniques consistent with many trafficking cases. They knew the buttons to press to get those young women to come work for them. 2 of our victims were locked in homes, whether it was because doorknobs were switched around or locks on windows were tightened down. Most of our victims were told that at some point they'd be able to leave if they earned enough money for a bus ticket or if they earned enough money to get back to where they needed to go.
The people who were holding her found her and took her, and that's another piece of the story that is terrifying, but she was found weeks later. From what I know, she was found naked with her mouth stapled shut as a threat not to talk in somewhere in a remote area outside Red Bluff.
It was an eye-opening experience for me investigating this crime when we started unraveling it. If you can imagine an onion and you're peeling back the layers, and it's like, how deep is it going to go and how much information can we find and figure out and connect the dots? It was really overwhelming. I mean, we worked on this for almost 2 years. It was ultimately very rewarding at the end when we were able to identify all the victims we did. That was a good feeling, yeah.
I can state with 100% certainty that illicit sexual activity is occurring within select numbers of our massage parlors. There's no doubt in that. We've got proof of that. It's quite easy for a patrol officer to go down, you know, one of our main thoroughfares and see that there's a massage parlor open at 1 a.m. That's not legitimate massage.
We first brought you the news 24 hours ago that Reading police cited people at 3 Reading massage parlors on accusations that they were offering more than just back rubs.
There's little doubt sex trafficking exists in Reading. To what degree, though, is not really known. Well, the city council is going to take a look at creating an ordinance for requiring permits for massage parlors to try and crack down on prostitution.
We now have a Reading municipal code that governs massage parlors. And we require that they are certified, and about 10% have been denied, and that's mainly for past prostitution record. I think that is a part of the greater picture in making sure that this legitimate business stays legitimate.
In most cases, the women performing the illicit sexual services are victims. Who's the victimizer there? It's the client. We can get at the client, we're gonna do this community a lot of good.
Just like any other business, this business would not be flourishing if people weren't buying sex. And these people look just like you and me. It's doctors, it's lawyers, it's the guy down the street with the wife and the kids. If people weren't buying sex, there wouldn't be this endless supply of people being victimized to kind of feed this industry.
I think if we can change that predatorial mindset where the belief is that it's okay to pay for sex, that's where it starts. We need heavier consequences on the predators that are out there doing that. We're going to do everything in our power to hold them accountable.
It's really hard to see. It's really hard to see because a lot of this goes on behind closed doors. It's not out in the public's view every day. You know, you're not going to just drive down the street and see a victim of human trafficking walking down. It could be somebody in the store that you're having a dealing with and you don't know what's going on in their life when in fact they could be being held against their will somewhere. It's very hidden. That's what makes it difficult.
It's an uncomfortable topic and people don't want to think that it's in their own backyard, but I think it's really important not to turn a blind eye. You know, be open and listen to people that are working with victims who know it's here, it's actually happening. And if you do that, then you're going to be able to talk to your daughters and your sisters, you know, and people that you care about.
I know our office has taken a very proactive approach in the last couple years with bringing law enforcement in, bringing first responders in, bringing service providers in, providing training to them on how to identify a trafficking case, whether it's just, you know, a beat officer who pulls over a car for speeding, and just a normal traffic stop could turn into or be the key evidence that we need if that officer knows what to look for.
The basic idea behind NCAT is, can we do something that would create motion in our community around human trafficking? And what I mean by motion, the motion that brings a community together, the motion that causes the community to get organized, the motion that causes the community's eyes to open. Oh, this is how sex for sale does take place. Oh, this is what human trafficking really is.
Once that education process is opened up, whether it's in the media, whether it's in private groups, or whether it's professional organizations talking to each other, it brings the awareness. And then following from that are the community members who learn about it, who just start talking. Because it's one of those topics that's shocking to like consider and think that this could happen.
We've had a great change. They think there's a great synergy in our community right now of people and organizations coming together to raise awareness, you know, to work on what are our protocols and our processes so when we find a victim, we can get that person right into services and make them feel safe and supported. And that's actually happening now.
I think one of the biggest motivators I've ever heard for people to get involved in a subject like this is you just have to imagine for 1 minute that that is your daughter, your wife, your sister, being sold, being held against her will, being forced to do unimaginable things multiple times a day. And you just have to think if it helps one person, just one,
then it's all worth it. If one person isn't sold for sex here in Reading, then all of it is worth it.